I mean, there's a lot of debate in the scientific literature about the meaning of dreams, and perhaps there's even debate about whether it's possible for dreams to have meaning. I think partly the debate exists because to do dream analysis properly, as Jung in particular pointed out, you need a vast body of knowledge in the dream interpreter about comparative mythology and ritual and symbol and art history and so forth, because dreams, of course, use images as their primary means of conceptualization. Now, in order to understand what dreams mean and how they can be useful in therapy, apart from appreciating the fact that the interpreter needs a broad body of knowledge that scientists generally don't develop, it's also important to know what it is that scientists have discovered about dreams. So, for example, we know that dreams occur during rapid eye movement sleep. You cycle into rapid eye movement sleep about every 90 minutes when you're asleep. When you're in rapid eye movement sleep, your motor centers, so your action centers, are very much activated in your brain, but your body is paralyzed so that you can't move around. Your eyes are moving because, of course, it doesn't really matter if your eyes move while you're asleep because they won't take you anywhere. But if your legs were moving while you were asleep, you'd run into walls while you were dreaming. And scientists have actually managed to damage the motor inhibition systems in cats so that they do move around when they're dreaming. Anyways, if you wake up, when someone's dreaming, their brain is about as active as it is when they're awake. So there's a tremendous amount of neural processing going on in the dream state. If you wake someone up when they're dreaming, there's about an 80% chance that they'll report the emotion of anxiety. Dreams tend to focus on threat processing. Now, a threat is anything that might hurt you, but it's more than that, too. A threat is anything that doesn't fit into your current conceptual scheme. So imagine that you have a theory about the way the world is, and then you act on that theory, and sometimes things work out the way you'd like them to work out, but often they don't. And every time things work out in a way that isn't how you would like or how you predicted, that indicates that there's some more about the world that you have to learn about. And that fact first manifests itself in anxiety. Now, the dream focuses on anxiety, and then it loosens up the normal conceptual constraints that characterize waking thinking, and it starts to play, in a sense, or hypothesize about how your current categorical structure could be shifted around so that that threat could be accounted for. Okay, now, that means the dream is dealing with things that you need to understand, but you don't yet understand. So when you wake up and you remember the dream doesn't really make sense because it's about something you don't understand. Now, it's your brain's best guess at configuring or understanding the unknowable. But it's like the first layer of a multi-layered process which eventually would culminate in fully developed thought. Maybe over months, or maybe over years, or maybe you would never manage it at all. The unknown thing or the threat is just too great to really come to any terms with it whatsoever. Okay, now imagine that you're dreaming about something and it produces enough emotion, the threat produces enough emotion not only to produce a very vivid dream, but to wake you up. And when you wake up, you remember the dream. And then you go tell someone about it. Well, the dream is about something you don't yet understand that's upsetting. And if you tell a bunch of people about it, they're going to give you all sorts of opinions on the dream. And that's a way that you can gather more information about the threat.
Are we talking about an extreme case which is known as a nightmare, or perhaps simply a dream which is faintly troubling or puzzling because it's so abstract? Could you differentiate between the two?
I think it's clearer in the case of nightmares, and often, too, because nightmares tend to have archetypal themes. You know, people, for example, are often threatened by monsters in nightmares. And a monster is a chimera that's made up of the different parts of frightening things. A dragon is a chimera, for example, because it's made out of reptilian parts, and it also includes the idea of fire and transformation. So a nightmare is a dream that tends to use archetypal imagery to conceptualize a fairly powerful threat. And if you recount a nightmare to a person with no specific training, they're going to have some opinion about it, and their opinion might be useful in terms of information gathering. But if you recount a dream to someone who's psychologically trained and who's also symbolically trained and who has, you know, great depth of knowledge with regards to the structure of religious thinking and comparative literature, the light that they're going to shed on your dream is much brighter and more profound. And sometimes a dream interpretation can offer the person who's had the dream a leap forward in knowledge that might have taken them 5 or 6 years to conceptualize by themselves.
An insight, you might say, that they wouldn't ordinarily have had, because the person who's the expert who's had the dream recounted to them knows and says, ah, yes, I know of that place that they say they've been to, that experience they've had, that symbol and its meaning, and above all, what it feels like. Because surely it is, some people say that, me included, that one way to interpret a dream when you wake up is to just, like you would taste a sip of wine, just hold the flavor and hold the feeling. What does it feel like? And what feels the same in your real life? And that's what the dream's trying to tell you, with a collage of symbols and memories as well that it's drawn on in recent conscious experience to try and put it together. Hence, the dream can be very abstract. Would you say that's the case sometimes?
Well, I think there's two things about your comments that are really worth highlighting. The first is the categories that a dream uses are generally based on emotional similarity rather than logical similarity.
Yes.
So a dream, for example, might represent fear or the fear of something unknown by using a juxtaposition of a variety of images of frightening things. So imagine that in the dream world, the basic rule is all things that produce the same emotion are the same thing. And so your description of a dream interpretation process that relies on identifying similarities in emotional state gets right to the core of how dream thought works. Now, secondarily, I also believe that if you are able to help someone construct a dream interpretation that fits, they're also able to feel that it fits. It clicks, or it makes sense, or it's like the punchline of a joke in some way. They can tell that the interpretation has put some missing pieces of the puzzle into place. And I think it's important to rely on that as an indicator of whether the interpretation is actually derived from the dream or sort of just a theoretical imposition on its structure. Now, we can go underneath that too. And I mentioned already that basic categories are more action-oriented than object-oriented. So the basic categories of the human mind are categories to do things with. Well, by the same token, there are also motivational and emotional categories. So the primordial mind, like the animal mind, thinks sort of axiomatically that all things that produce the same emotion are the same thing. So there's things that make you happy, or there's things that make you sad, or there's things that make you anxious. And the fact that all those things share the capacity to evoke that emotion speaks of some essential identity between them. Now, the identity is in relationship to the experiencer and not necessarily with regards to similarity between the objects. But it's still how we naturally think, and it's certainly how mythology thinks, and it's how drama thinks, and how religion thinks. And we've lost sight of that in part because we've become scientifically trained to some degree, and we tend to believe that the real categories of the world are objective. And that just strikes me as it's wrong. There's something about it that's wrong. And it's wrong because we have to act.